मॉर्निंग।
गुड मॉर्निंग मैम।
गुड मॉर्निंग मैम।
गुड मॉर्निंग मैम।
गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन।
गुड मॉर्निंग मैम।
गुड मॉर्निंग मैम।
गुड मॉर्निंग।
Shankar, Principal Ma'am, Vice Principal Ma'am, teachers, and dear students. We have amongst us Miss Himanjali Shankar, an author and a passionate teacher. She grew up in the city of Joy, Kolkata, and studied literature. She completed her master's and MPhil in English from Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. She has tried her hands in both children's fiction and adult novels. Her first book being The Magical Adventure of Skinny Scribbles was published in 2012. She has been awarded the FICCI Publishing Award for Upcoming Author of the Year in 2018 for her book Mrs. C Remembers. Some of her magical work has been inspired by her Labrador called Russo. To name a few, like The Stupendous Time-Telling Dog and Missing, a Magnificent Super Dog. It is lovely to have you here with us, ma'am, and I request you to take us through this session.
Hello, hi everyone. I think I can see quite a few of, there are more people who I can't see also, right? Yeah. Okay, yeah. Oh, there's lots of people. Okay, there are three sets of students.
Yes.
Someone's speaking over us. Yeah. Okay. So this is very, I don't know, I feel like it's almost like science fiction or something when we do this Zoom call. And I've not done it with so many people before. So I feel like this is kind of unreal, like it's out of, you know, you used to, like, these are the changes that have happened because of COVID. And I hope all of you must be also getting used to this. And you all will be more used to it than me because you must be having classes like this, but in this way. But for me, it's still very disorienting. In I do have meetings, I mean, Zoom meetings, but yeah, I'm just still getting used to it. So, okay, I know y'all won't be able to speak because y'all are muted, but if it's possible, towards the end, we can take some questions. If there are any, or if someone wants to ask a question, if they can be unmuted at some point. So we can do that as we go along. We'll see how that's working. So as you all were told, I've written these books on a super dog. There's one of them is next to me. This is called the Stupendous Time Telling Super Dog. This is the first book in the series. And there's one more called Missing a Magnificent Super Dog. And those who I can see, any of you have dogs, you can just put your hands up because you can't speak. Any of you have dogs? Okay. There are a few people with dogs. There's a, I'm going on to the next page. Yeah, I can see now. Okay, there are quite, so some people have dogs and those who don't have dogs. But any of you who don't have any animals, but would like to have a dog or would like to have some pet, right? Yeah. And yeah, there's quite a lot of people who would like to have a pet. So it's because I think when my children were also really small, they used to keep saying that they want to have a dog, they want to have a dog. And I used to, and I'm sure some of you must be pestering your family that you want to have a dog and please keep a dog. But what happens mostly is that your parents will say that no, because it's a lot of work. Keeping a dog means a lot of work for the whole family, for everyone, because dogs are also like children. They don't grow up. So you have to feed them, you have to walk them, you have to do everything for them, which is why your mother or father or any family members will be saying no. And I used to do that also with my daughters. I used to keep saying that no, we will not have a dog. But they used to go on. And then actually, I am also fond of dogs. So after some time, I was like, okay. And we kept a dog. And his name is Russo, which is also the name of the dog in this book. And in some ways, this dog, I have based him on my Russo. Now Russo is, of course, this book was written 9-10 years back. But Russo was then it was 8 years back, I think. Russo is now 11 years old. So he's like a senior citizen, like a old man, so he's not as naughty as he used to be. But when he was small, he was really a very difficult dog. It was impossible to control him. He would do, and I think I was also, I'm not good at being, at imposing discipline. I'm not good at being strict. So Russo is a particularly badly behaved dog. And he used to do things like, you know, I can remember once when we had guests who had come to the house and we served them tea, and Russo went and just put his tongue into that person's tea and went slup. He took a sip of tea and it was very horrifying. And we had to really say, sorry. Like it was so embarrassing as a, you know, to have to explain that kind of behavior. So he's always done those kind of things. And he's like, when people came, he would jump on them. He would almost knock them over, things like that. Quite uncontrollable. And so I think he thinks he is the boss or he's the manager in our house, that he has to look after everyone and he's the one in control. Even in winter, he sleeps on the bed and he's like, he takes up half the bed. He'll be snoring loudly. He's almost pushing us off the bed. So things like that have happened for so many years. So the reason I'm talking so much about my dog is because when it comes to writing, and I'm sure, I mean, I know you're like young, but I'm sure many of you are already writing or are fond of writing stories or essays or even in whatever form or reading. So I just want to say that when you write something, it usually comes from, it's about things you like. It's about things which which you're interested in, which fascinate you. So when I wrote this book, it was Lefty Rousseau especially was a very, I mean, he still is a very important part of my life. So when I wanted to write a book, it was about a dog. But of course, when you write a story, it's not like, I don't know if any of you keep a journal or a diary. If you're fond of writing, that's a great practice, where you just at the end of the day, maybe write about what happened during the day. It doesn't have to be anything too much, but just some events, incidents that happened. Today I ate this for lunch, or today I chatted with my friend and she said, or he said, whatever. So things like that, if you just want to make a record. But the thing is that, so that is a practice that you can have of writing. But of course, that is not a book. That is not a story. That is your record of what is happening in your life. But when you write a story, then you use what you know, what is there in your life, and you make it into a story. Which is why when I wrote the book, I couldn't just write about like the way I was talking to y'all about what Rousseau does. That wouldn't be a story. So in the book, I made the dog into a super dog. And so I had to, all of you will be familiar with superheroes, like a Superman, Batman, and there are some also anti-heroes. There'll be a Voldemort and all of that. So there are superheroes, there's anti-heroes, there's villains. So all these, usually what happens with the superhero? A superhero has a superpower, which helps them to usually improve the world or change the world or save the world, really. A superhero has a superpower like, Superman can fly. And so you use that superpower in certain ways to save the world. And usually there's a villain in a superhero story. And the villain is someone who the hero has to, not destroy, but yeah, has to defeat. And then in a superhero story also there are often some magical elements, things which there can be. I mean, every story doesn't have to have the same things, but these are the things that make a superhero adventure. So there's an adventure that the superhero goes on. And all these things happen in a superhero story. There's often a place which is like, Krypton in Superman, or even in Hogwarts in Harry Potter. There's usually a place where it's a magical place where things are happening which are different from the earth, from where we stay. So these are all the things that happen in superhero adventure stories. So, but of course, there are different things you can do with any story or any format, so to say. Like stories can have, stories can be mysteries, you can have adventures, you can have a funny story, you can have a Panchatantra, which will be more folk tales, there can be mythology, there can be so many different kinds of stories. And sometimes when you write a story, you can mix two ways of writing. Like, so this book, while it's a superhero story, but it's also funny and it's not so serious. It's not a very serious superhero story. There's an adventure in it, but it's also supposed to be fun. So here I was mixing different types of story writing, which is also something you can do when you write a story. It doesn't always have to be exactly in one way. You can use your imagination, your thoughts, your ideas to write in different ways and to create a different sort of story. So, when I think of stories, I often think of stories as being magical, as being like magic, as magic in a, not in the sense of, I'm sure you all have been for magic shows and you've seen those, like a rabbit coming out of a hat or ribbons coming out. I mean, things coming out of thin air, coming out of nothing. But that, I don't mean that sort of magic when I'm talking about a story. What I mean is that a story seems to be magical because you are sitting in one place, you're reading a story, but just through that story, the story is taking you to different places. It's making you meet people you've never met. So it's like making new friends. It's like when you sometimes read a story where you really like a character, so that person, you start understanding the character in that book, in that story. You identify with that person, person in the story. So that makes it almost like making a new friend. I mean, and I think you're sort of really, you can really interact with the story, which is almost like if you really love a story, it can become almost like a magical experience, because through it, you're traveling to new places, you're meeting new people and doing all these wonderful things. Sometimes you imagine that you are part of that story, and that can be a lot of fun. Okay, I also want to give a disclaimer, so to say, I know that everyone reads, and all of us, there are a lot of, there are children who also don't enjoy reading stories. I mean, I know that it's not that I'm trying to say that you have to love reading a certain storybooks or fiction. So I feel like if you have different kind of interests, like, and you know, reading is something that is very basic. Whatever, anything, like even if I'm looking at the newspaper, I'm reading. If I'm looking at, say, a hoarding, some advertisement, that's also reading, because there are words there. So reading, I mean, there are lots of ways in which you're being told stories. You don't really always think of it as a story, but they are stories. Even an advertisement can be a story, because it's telling you something. So the whole thing of what I mean is, you don't have to force yourself to read a certain, you can read what you like reading. So it can be that maybe you don't, some children don't enjoy, adventure story, but they might enjoy, you might just like science more. So you might want to read real things. What do you seem more like connected to the real world? You like to read about people who made scientific discoveries. You can read, so there's so much of writing out there. There are so many stories. So you have this whole world of the written word. So you can choose. You can choose what you like. Everyone doesn't like reading the same things, or everyone doesn't enjoy reading the same things. And so after a point, like, you don't have to always, because reading is meant to be pleasure. It's not like something you have to do you don't have to force yourself to do. Then the whole point of reading is lost. It has to be something you love. It has to be something you enjoy. So I would say that if you don't like reading a certain kind of story, after a point, don't force yourself. Then you try reading something else. You look at something else and see what you enjoy and what works for you, because there's so much out there. So it's a matter of finding what you like and identifying with that. So those are my views on reading. But anyway, I have to come back. So whether you enjoy reading funny adventure stories or not, today you have to listen to my story, which is about, as I said, the super dog. And so I'm going to start by reading a little bit. And after that, let me read a bit, and then I'll tell you what we should do next. So this is just to give you a sense of what the story is about. And so this is the first chapter. I'll read a little bit from the first chapter. Rousseau, an insane, wonderful and handsome dog, lived with two little girls, Kavya and Anya, and their mother, Mrs. Ghosh. Rousseau enjoyed being the only man in the house. And okay, when I finish and when we open up for questions, you can ask me any questions that you have, and about anything, about reading, writing, about this story, any other story, we can talk about different things. So, let me just continue now. So he barked at the girls when they made too much noise. He was the first to reach the door when anyone knocked, and he welcomed every visitor with a hug. That is, he put his paws on their shoulders and pushed them against the wall. Some people did not enjoy this, which the Ghosh family thought was a little mean-minded of them. But so the girls, you know, they had to spend a lot of time explaining Rousseau's behavior to people, to other children, because Rousseau was a very badly behaved dog. And there's a story, I'm skipping a little, And then Anya was fighting with a girl in a pink dress who had called Russo stupid and mad. They were playing in the playground. And this happened. "Not stupider than you," said Anya. "And he may be a little mad, but he's also very clever, you know. He can tell the time, even though he is only a dog." This was true. There was one very strange and clever thing Russo could do. He had one superpower. He could tell the time. So this is Russo's superpower. It's a superpower because he's a dog. Because obviously human beings can tell the time. But if he's a dog who can tell the time, so that becomes a superpower. "Every afternoon when the girls returned from school, Russo greeted them with great enthusiasm and slobbering leaps. But Kavya knew how to calm him down. "What is the time, Russo?" she would ask quickly. And Russo would start telling the time in his special way. Suppose it was 3:15. He would give three short, smart barks, like woof, 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 with his tail held high. Then he would sit with his right paw in the air for 5 seconds and thump his tail on the ground 3 times to denote 3 sets of 5. That is 15. Thump, 5, thump, 10, thump, 15. I don't know. Do you all know your timetables, which is like the 5 times table and the each of the timetables. So when you know the time, somebody's sharing. So when you know your timetables, you can tell time the way Russo does. So it's actually quite simple. So for 3, he did woof, woof, woof. Then he puts his paw in the air and then he does thump, thump, thump with his tail. So 5, 10, 15. So it's 3:15. "Good dog. Thank you so much." Kavya would pat his head. Russo would jump up again in delight, grinning foolishly with his tongue hanging out. And if the time was like, I won't go into the details, but if it's 17, if it's 3:17, there are ways he had of telling the seconds also. So like mathematically, what you would call Russo's style of telling time could be called the tally method. But Russo, of course, had no name for it. He just knew how to do it without knowing how he knew. It might sound complicated, but it was easy really, once you got used to it. And the Ghosh family hardly ever looked at clocks or watches when Russo was around. And Russo loved to tell the time. It made him proud and happy. Kavya and Anya made Russo perform this little trick many times to neighbors and friends who thought the Ghoshes were crazy. Some of them did grudgingly admit that it worked. Somehow this bizarre method of time telling was strangely accurate. But anyway, apart from this extraordinary trait, Russo was an ordinary dog in an ordinary family until the day that the orange marmaladies from the black hole of time attacked time itself. So, you know, we were talking about, I was telling you about how in an adventure story, there's often a magical land which is located away from the real world. So in this story, there is something called the Mama Land, where the orange marmaladies stay. And I'll tell you a little bit about the marmaladies. The orange marmaladies were the original timekeepers of the universe. They lived in Mama Land in the black hole of time. At the very end of a dark, windy tunnel in the black hole of time stood the master clock of rock. The master clock of rock was as tall as 3 giraffes standing on top of each other, which is very high, and as wide as 3 long crocodiles lying down in a line. It had been carved out of a mountainside made of granite and ice, so it was hard and slippery. And on the face of the master clock were 3 long and thin orange hands. No, like a clock has, like when you look at a clock, it has hands, what we call hands. But this clock has real hands, like a person, like my hand, like a real hand. There were 3 long and thin orange hands, like an orange colored hands with narrow wrists and sharp rainbow colored fingernails that pointed to the time. So it would point at the time like this. The black hole of time is actually a hole in the universe a little way off from Earth. But the marmaladies love to slide out of the black hole and land on Earth with a bump and go around exploring, chattering loudly all the while. They were curious and inquisitive creatures. Now, I'm not going to go into the story too much because if you read it or if you have read it, you'll know. But the orange marmaladies are invisible. So we as human beings can't see them. But they sometimes come to Earth and they start roaming around. But even if there's an orange arm marmalade sitting right in front of me now, I can't see him or her. But you know, they are friendly creatures. They are not like the villains in very serious stories. They're sweet and friendly and wobbly, and they want to be friends. They want to make friends with humans. But as I said, they are invisible. So, and they are the original timekeepers of the universe. So there is a whole backstory here about how earlier they could be seen by human beings, but slowly over the centuries and over time, they became invisible. So now what's happened is the marmaladies are really upset. They want to be visible to human beings again. And the marmaladies are very sad. They're still sad. They might be waving their hands in your face as you sit here, but you might be looking through them as if they do not exist, because they don't exist for you. It's not your fault, but it does make the marmaladies quite mad at you. So annoying. The marmalade hovering in front of your face might be saying, and so rude, she might add, feeling that you're deliberately ignoring her. So as the story goes on, the marmaladies, what they do is they try to come up with a plan. They try to come up with a way of becoming visible to human beings so that human beings can see them. They want to be friends with human beings. But this plan goes wrong and they do not become visible. What happens instead, because the plan goes wrong, is that time disappears from the world, from our world. So it's like, you know, how do you know the time? You knew that you have to say, I would send a message saying that today we'll have this session at 11:30. So you knew that you have to log in at 11:30 into this ID. Now, if there's no time, we couldn't do any of these things. Like if you don't have mechanical time, the time as we know it, it would become, the world would sort of be thrown into chaos and confusion. Because there are so many ways we tell the time, right? We see the time on mobile phones. We see it on, of course, on our computers, on laptops, on every kind of device that we have now, whatever you're using, it has time. It tells you the time. And so suddenly, if that time goes away, if you can't see the time, alarm clocks don't ring, you can imagine what sort of confusion there would be. So in this story, that's what happens. The time suddenly disappears from the world. So I'm just going to read, this is the last part I'll read. It's the day that the marmaladies have made their plan and they've tried to become visible to human beings. But instead, what's happened is time has disappeared. So that morning in the world, all over the world, it's like all of us wake up and we suddenly find that there is no time. Our phones are not telling us the time. Television doesn't have time. Laptops don't have time. There is no time that we can see. Even microwave ovens, think of so many gadgets that we use. There are so many, all these gadgets, all of them stop telling you the time. And so the whole world is in sort of chaos. And then, you know, how do you go to the, like, this is of course not in COVID times. So children are going to the bus stop. They have to go to school. They have to know exactly when to go to the bus stop. And no one is being able to do any of that. So, but only the Ghosh family, what happens is because they have Russo who tells them the time. So as the Ghosh family, they hurry towards the bus stop, they were surprised by all the shouting and running around that was going on. Parents were asking each other, but what is the time? What has happened? There was tension and hysteria everywhere. My alarm did not go off, Mr. Ali said, probably for the fifth time. Mine neither. So there's a parents at the bus stop, they're all panicked, agitated, they don't know what to do. And then somehow the bus comes and the bus driver and the bus conductor are also looking very confused. And the parents are crowding at the window and the bus driver is peering down. He's uncertain what to do. And there is a lot of, I mean, the parents, when they're leaving the bus stop also, they're saying, so how do we come to pick up the children again? How do we know when to come? Because we don't have the clocks. So all this is happening. And then parents started drifting homewards, peering anxiously at their watches and cell phones and worrying about how they would find out the time. But Mrs. Ghosh was thinking about coffee and a slice of toast. She was not worried at all. She had Russo at home. So what happens in this story is that because time disappears from the world, then Russo, because he's not a mechanical, like say watches and clocks and all are mechanical means of telling time. But because he has a natural connect by which he tells the time, so he doesn't lose. He can still tell the time. And in this book, this is about, it's also a funny story about how Russo suddenly becomes really important. He goes on television and he has to tell the time to the whole world so that people know what the time is. And then how he behaves crazy at the television studio. He's running around, causing a lot of trouble. So it's a funny adventure story about this whole, there's a whole week or I forget how long actually, because I've also written this a long time back, but there's a whole period of time when there's no, like, no one knows the time and there's a lot of confusion. And then Russo's a superhero who's telling the time. And then finally, Russo helps to bring time back into the world. So that's the story. And the sequel is about missing a magnificent super dog in which Russo is kidnapped by the Mama ladies because they don't want, they want time to go away again and they want to become visible again. So that's also another story of the same sort. So, okay, I'm going to share screen because I want to, I'll see if I can show you a couple of videos that I have. It's a little video that we made at home actually. So because I was talking about how we tell stories, right? I mean, how you see things around you and you can make up stories from that. So this is to show you how I came up with Russo's stories. Because Russo would do funny things in the house. And this is just like, this is just a simple recording of my dog Russo doing silly things in the house. And it's just a little funny story that we've put out with what Russo did. This is not exactly what happens in the book, but it's just a little story made around that. So, okay, let me share screen and show it to you. I hope this, yeah, okay, I should be able to. So this is about, the first one I'll show you is about, there's a super dog who is relaxing. So he's relaxing now, he's finished his mission, he's taking a break and he's enjoying his life. So here, I hope the sound comes also.
Yes, it should.
Oh, 1 minute. No, I'm not sure. Are you able to? Okay. You can hear, right? I mean, the sound is coming. I can't tell if everyone can. No.
No, sound's not coming, but we can see.
Oh, okay. Then it's a bit of a waste. Because this is, actually, there's a, okay, let me see if I can put the sound on. Audio. I think I don't know how to share the sound. Then should I be playing it at all? This is the first time I've tried to share like a video. I don't know if, okay, you can just watch it. It's just like, I'll tell you what it is. Yeah. It's just sure. A little, it's another 5 seconds. So Russo is playing Scrabble. Okay, I think I won't play the other one because it's no point without the audio. So this was about Superdog, what he's doing when he's relaxing. He's playing Scrabble. He's watching television and he's giving his views on what he's watching. Then, you know, when he was sitting with the toilet paper, he's trying to promote hygiene in the world. It's just like funny, silly little things. So I have a couple more videos, but I'm not playing them then. So these are just like, you know, how you can play around with things that happen around you and how it can give you ideas about what to do with them and how to write stories and things. So I think now, let me just open up for, if you all have questions.
Yes.
Yes.
Aletha, if we may give the children the, you know, if they can unmute themselves, if they have any questions.
Yes, ma'am.
Anyone who has a question, you can unmute yourself and speak one at a time, please. Janavi, you want to ask something?
Yes.
Yes, please go ahead, Janavi.
Ma'am, when you think to write a story on a particular thing and you cannot get ideas, then how do you start?
Okay. When you have the ideas and you think and you have, how do you start? Actually, starting, that's a very important thing, because starting is very, I mean, to have a good start is very important, because, you know, if you don't have a good start to a story, then people lose interest. They don't want to read more. So it's important to spend a lot of time to think of how to start a story. So it can be, you can think of different ways. You can start with dialogue, with somebody saying something. Usually I would say start with something surprising, like say something that people wonder, oh, what is going on? Or, you know, something mysterious. So that beginning a story of a story is very important. So you should spend some time in thinking, how do I begin my story? You know what you want to say, but once you have the beginning, it's actually helps you to go on in a sort of, is that the question? I mean, is that what you're asking?
Yes, I think they're great ideas. No, you start with the surprise, or you know, with a dialogue or something. Okay, Janvi?
Okay.
Okay, now you mute yourself again, please. Ankita Mohan, you can unmute yourself and ask.
Are there any more novels coming up of the Super Dog series?
Oh, you know, I'm thinking of writing one more. There's just two as of now. But I have been thinking of a third story, but I haven't written it yet.
Okay, so hopefully soon. Okay, Riddhi, you're next. So unmute yourself, Riddhi. Riddhi Rupkotha, unmute yourself. Yes, Riddhi, you're getting muted constantly. Please unmute yourself. Yes. Yeah, but there's a lot of disturbance, Riddhi. Yes, try quickly. We can't hear you, Riddhi. Why don't you?
Yeah, you can write it. No, I couldn't hear. Yes. Can you write your question? We can see it.
Yeah,
exactly.
Late.
Yeah.
Yes. Why don't you send it through the chat box, Riddhi?
Chat is disabled.
Okay, we'll fix it.
I've enabled it.
Yes. So you can write. You know, Riddhi. Yes, Harnoor, you're next. Harnoor, please unmute yourself.
Ma'am, yes. At what age did you develop an interest in writing?
What age? I think, you know, like from your age, I think from the time I was quite young, from like in class 3-4, that I was really interested in writing. Of course, that time I didn't know that I would be writing books, but I wanted to. I wanted to write stories. I was very fond of reading. Also, that's a very, I mean, I'm sure all of you know that it's very important to read a lot. I mean, I still read a lot, because that's how you develop yourself as a writer too, by seeing how much great literature has been written by other people. Like, because you read all your favorite authors and you'll want to write like them. And I think that's what happened first. I would read a book which I really loved and I would say, oh, I wish I could write a story like this. And that's how you start trying. Yeah.
Yeah. Honorini, you're next. You can unmute yourself and ask. Honorini. Unmute yourself. You can't unmute yourself.
Yes
you can. Yes.
Yes, ma'am. How can I increase the power of my imagination to write a story?
I think, you know, the best is just to keep reading. Because the more you read, the more ideas you get. More, like, I still find that, you know, when I'm reading, like recently I was reading a book which it was written in a very strange, different kind of way. So I started wanting to write in... I felt like, oh, now I must also try writing in this way. So reading is the best way. And also, of course, even TV, the shows you watch, or anything that you, anything really can make you sort of stimulate your writing. If you're going out for a walk and you see a flower, that can also just, so you just have to be open to the idea. You must let your imagination work in any way it wants at any point of time. Don't try to, let yourself think all the time.
Okay, Rishita Bagaria, Rishita, you're next. Please unmute yourself.
Oh, there are a lot of questions now. I should see them.
Ma'am, good afternoon, ma'am. Can you suggest some books to read?
It also depends on what you like to read. Do you like, say there's Roald Dahl, there's Enid Blyton, there's it's difficult to suggest for me because I feel like it should also depend on what you like to read. But there I can suggest some things like if you are interested in, I know this author called Anushka Ravi Shankar. She's written Moen and the Monster. That's a really funny story, if you like funny stories, about a little crazy little monster who stays under the bed. So you should just look around. You should maybe, what you should do is sometimes maybe on the internet, you look at a story and see what the story is about. And then you see if it interests you. You should see if you're like reading the back cover of a book, the blurbs, what we call written about a book. Check out what is being written about different books and see what is of interest to you. Looking, that's one way of choosing an author.
I think Rishika has a question about the Marmaladies. Rishika, why don't you ask the question to ma'am? Rishika Paul, she's written in the chat. Rishika Paul, kindly unmute yourself and ask the question.
Ma'am, if the Marmaladies were visible only when time wasn't there, then the Marmaladies were visible at the first, then there was no time that time.
Yeah, so you know, in the universe, we like in the world, till say we didn't, I'm talking about like prehistoric times, till clocks were invented or like the sand, what was it? Those hourglasses and all of those were invented. So earlier people used to just know the time by looking at the sun. They used to guess the time. In those days, Marmaladies were visible to human beings. But as the world became more mechanical, so then they were not required anymore. They didn't have to tell time to people because we found ways of telling time ourselves through clocks and watches and all of that. Which is why, and so that time they started slowly disappearing till they completely disappeared. And now what happens in the story is they want to come back and interact with human beings.
Okay, thank you. And okay, I think we'll take Vatsal's question. Vatsal has a very interesting question. Ma'am, I'm interested in writing fictional adventure. How can I improve?
I would say the same thing about reading more. So you look at you read more adventure stories. Maybe you watch, even on television, you watch more adventure movies, action movies. And from those, maybe what you could do is write down ideas. When you're reading something, maybe you could stop at some point and it makes you think of something else. So you note down an idea and then that becomes your idea. And you kind of plan some adventure story with that. So that's how you just keep stimulating your own imagination, using it as much as you can.
Himanjali ma'am, the children want to know your favorite author.
My favorite author? Okay, my favorite author when I was younger, like when I used to really love Roald Dahl a lot, like, you know, Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. I used to read a lot of Enid Blyton, which I think now, I don't know if you all read that anymore so much. Because I know my children didn't like Enid Blyton the way I did when I was small. So I used to love Famous Five and all of, you know, the Five Findouters. But then I found that that's not so popular anymore. So that's not my... And now as an adult, I have different favorite authors. Like my favorite author now is Margaret Atwood, who writes for adults.
So, okay. Yeah. Okay, Shomarjo is asking, did you invent the method in which Rousseau tells time?
Yeah, I just came up with that method really. Random. Because I actually it was also like a little joke I had at home about how Rousseau sometimes is telling, my Rousseau is telling the time, and then I kind of created a method with that.
And there are many children who've asked the same question. Just a minute, I'll speak, and then after that I'll give you a chance, darling. So Himanshu ma'am, there are many children who from the chat I can see that they've all they want to know how could they improve their writing skill.
Okay, writing again, reading a lot. Firstly, reading itself, because when you read a lot, then you come across new words. When you, I'm not saying that you should always stop reading and look at a dictionary, but when you read a lot, you'll see that over time you know more meaning. You are able to understand more words. When you're reading, also of course grammar is improving because you can see exactly how the language is being used. It's not something that you have to also very consciously do. Sometimes what happens is just reading helps your I don't think I sat down and thought, oh, this is how I'm becoming a better writer. But I know that as I read more, even today, my own writing skills also improve. Of course, in class and in school, there'll be ways that your teachers will be helping you to improve your writing. Like, and so grammar is important, spellings are important, and then of course your imagination and all of that.
And Himanjali ma'am, our principal has a very interesting question for you. And she wants to know whether Russo plays Scrabble. And there she is.
Well,
good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon. I want to say yes, but I imagine he could play Scrabble. But seriously, I think no. Russo cannot play Scrabble.
And there are some very profound questions being asked by the children.
Yeah.
I know. I really don't know whether we'll get the time to answer everything. But someone asked over here, how do you come up with the titles to your books?
Oh, that's also interesting. So titles, you know, what happens is it's not always only me. Because when I write, you also, when you're writing, you know how a book gets made. So I'm just writing a story. Then I'm sending it to the editor, the publisher. And the publisher can also come up with ideas, like the cover of a book, how it gets made. So there's a designer who'll make the cover, who'll imagine what the cover should be like. So in this case, I think, I can't remember who came up with the title, but we had a lot of discussions. We had a list of titles, like me and my editor, and we kept discussing which would be a good idea. And then finally, and it's kind of important. This usually happens after the book is written, that you're then trying to decide the title. And yeah, it's a collaboration. It comes with discussion.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, Ohana, you've been wanting to ask a question for a very long time. So come on. Yes.
Ma'am, how did you get the motivation to write books?
I actually started writing books. Well, like many of you, I was interested in writing from the time I was young. But sometimes what happens, I'm sure all of you will face, that you start writing, but you don't know how to finish the story, or you have ideas, but you don't really end up writing. So that used to happen earlier. But I think only when I became much older, when I was working, that's when I really felt like, okay, I'm getting older and I must do what I want to do. So I had this desire to write, which was very strong. That's when I think I was about 35 or something when I actually started writing books.
Can I ask something?
I think, Alia, and that's the last question. And then after that, Himanjali ma'am, if you don't mind, could we share your email with the children? Because everybody wants to ask a question, and then they can ask a question and you can reply at your leisure.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. I would just, Alia, before you ask the question, I would like to read this message from Principal ma'am. And ma'am, why don't you address the children, please? That would be so nice. Please. Mrs. Shaha, if you could just address the children. Ma'am has to be unmuted. Ma'am has to be unmuted. Ushma ma'am, if you could kindly tell Shreya to
unmute. Ma'am, I think.
Ma'am, I've been doing it from here.
Yes. Kindly unmute, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
So I just thought I'll come and say hello to Himanjali, particularly for you, because she's been a dear, dear friend. And my message to all our young ones today is something I've learned from Himanjali, that it's okay to be crazy. It's okay to be completely mad. It's okay to have fun. Being a writer doesn't mean that you have to be serious and you have to have your glasses on all the time and look at life very, very seriously. So I think this is Himanjali, and I'll tell you a secret. She's boobly to me. So this is boobly's secret: to really enjoy life and to be like a child and to have mischief and sparkle in her eyes, always intact as she does right now. And to enjoy every moment to the fullest, and I've used many L's here, to the fullest, as much as you can. And when you do that, children, you'll have so much to write about. There'll be so much that you want to talk about, write about, share. So the only secret that I know, and something that I have really experienced magically with Himanjali or Boobly as I know her, is to have fun and to really be mad about, crazy about living life to the fullest. So thank you, Himanjali or Boobly, for being with us. I can't tell you what this means to me. Thank you so much.
I agree. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. And yes, Alia, we'll take your question. Yes, Alia. Yes, Alia, are you going to ask the question?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, I was telling that if someone wants to write a book, they have someone has thought the idea and all of that, but can't write. The author needs some special skills or something that to write some stories.
Actually, that is true. I mean, that's a good question, because it's just having ideas just is not enough. So there's something more that you need to be able to write, which I can't explain what it is, but it all these things that what we are talking about, the ideas, the, of course, language, grammar, spellings, all of that has to be fine. I mean, of course, there. But after that, your imagination, your mind, all of everything has to come together where you have to be able to do it. And that's a certain special spark, which I'm sure a lot of authors have that. And yeah, but it doesn't mean that everyone can be an author. So just because you have an idea, it's like for any job, really, everyone has their own special skills, or everyone has their own special calling, so to say. So everyone can't do everything, which is fine. So being an author is also like that. It's really like another job. So you have to have those skills that need you to, you know,
write stories.
To write stories also. It is also like any other job, really.
Okay, thank you. I think, you know, if we would allow the children to ask questions, I think all of them have a question and they could just go on and on. So since Himanjali ma'am has given us the permission, so what we are going to do is we are going to share her email ID with you, and you can write to her, and I'm sure she is going to answer, but she will answer at her convenience. But do check your mail, okay? Yeah. And I think that would be lovely. And I think, Himanjali ma'am, I mean, you know, it was a pleasure attending this session, because I am a great fan of your Superdog series. I love it. And I remember once a friend of mine, Swati, was in conversation with you regarding your book, Mrs. C Remembers, and I had attended that session. And before that, I had read your Superdog series, and I was absolutely in love with them. And ever since then, I've been hounding Shorbani that, you know, if we could have a session with you. This lockdown actually came as a blessing, and we were able to, you know, kind of, I mean, you know, have you in, you know, as we could meet up with you virtually, if not, I mean, you know, of course, physically it was impossible. And I think I couldn't agree more with Mrs. Shaha when she says that, you know, we must learn to enjoy every minute of our lives, because we just don't know from where we can find the story. you know.
That's true.
And I guess being observant is important. And above all, I think we really have to live life, and we have to be positive, and we have to remain happy. And you just don't know, children, from where round the bend something's going to crop up and you can turn it into a story. And I would like to tell you, Himanjali ma'am, that all of them are actually, you know, they have actually written a lockdown diary, because that was, yes, that was a part of their summer vacation, you know, holiday assignment. And they had to, they were maintaining a journal. So since, you know, since you mentioned about
it,
yes, I think that, you know, you can kind of revisit it, and, you know, you can think about it. And in case you have a pet, and then, you know, you can look at it and, you know, think of the superpowers the pet might have, or you wish to, you know, give to the pet. Okay, because I think we can only depend on superpowers now so as to, you know, take us through this pandemic. So on behalf of everybody, on behalf of the entire MBWA family, I would love to thank you for taking time off and addressing our children. And although I know that, yes, they did ask some very profound questions, because, you know, they're really young. They're in classes 3, 4, and 5. And for them, it's like an author coming to meet them. So therefore, you know, they have to ask these questions, which I think they can't ask the teacher, because perhaps the teachers cannot answer these questions. So, and thank you, Sharbani, for helping organize this meeting. And thank you, ma'am, for sparing time and... you know, attending our session. Thank you to Jinook, who has been attending this session, I think, from the Telegraph. And thank you, teachers, for being here with us. Thank you much. And thank you. Our technical support. Without you, we wouldn't have been able to do this. Thank you, Himanjali ma'am. And I hope that, you know, the children are going to ask you some fun-loving questions also, other than philosophical and serious questions, now that they know what kind of a person you are. And we look forward to them sharing your answers with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. It was really, I have to say that it was a great pleasure being, I'm always skeptical of Zoom kind of things and how I'm going to handle it. But it was a great pleasure, and really smart, bright questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.